Mamas, and so we're gonna have a live lamb this year. I'm really excited. Oh, it's supposed to be a secret. Oh, I'm sorry. Live animals. We've got a really cool multimedia. I'm sorry. Deflated. Sorry. We got a cool multimedia that we're doing just to really show the cross of Christ and the resurrection. I'm telling you, it's going to be a powerful day. Of course, we end with our Easter egg hunt. The kids love that, and it's refreshments and stuff. But can I just invite you and ask you to invite someone to come to church with you on Easter? Like, everybody just say, I'm going to think of one person that I can invite and say, hey, why don't you come along with me on Easter Sunday, especially if they don't have a church to go to. They don't know Jesus. This is an opportunity. We're going to pack this house out, but more importantly, we're going to share Jesus, and we're going to celebrate. We're going to worship together the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I am so, so excited for that.
Did I ruin everything?
No, you're fine. Oh, that's okay. I'll have to think of something else to surprise everybody with, but that's okay. It's all right. I love you anyways. But I just want to say, though, like, I'm so thankful that you are bold to lead us into worship like that and to go, like, to not be afraid, right, to live out biblical worship and biblical gifts of the Spirit. And I'm just so thankful that you're bold. So good. Okay. So for Easter, this is an announcement from Katie, our kids pastor. And so I don't know if you guys have noticed, but we have a lot more kids coming, which is so exciting. And we're opening up another classroom to as we expand. But she did want to put it out to the whole church. She is needing help, especially the day before Saturday and the day of Easter, which is Sunday Easter. So let me just read it because it has all the things and I'm going to miss something. So she says, RL Kids is excited to celebrate the resurrection and the life of Jesus this coming Easter. We are in need of extra volunteers to help the day run smoothly. If you like to set up, painting, filling eggs, greeting new families, jumping in to help with crowd control, passing out candy, or cleaning up all the mess, we have a place for you. Setup is Saturday, April 16th from 10 a.m. to 12:30, and there are many different ways to help on Easter Sunday, the 17th. Signups for both Saturday and Sunday are at every RL Kids check-in station in the fireside room. So you can go physically after service and sign up at the check-in stations, and she'll get in touch with you. Or you can email her at katie@resonatelife.tv. Thank you for helping us plant seeds of truth and love into the hearts of our kids and every family that visits on Easter Sunday. So that was her message. Please, you guys, we are going to have a lot of visitors. And so if you can help out with that, that's great. Good news is we are getting more chairs in here and chairs in the fireside room. So we don't have to do two services for Easter. We're just going to get, we're going to pack us all in, and it's going to be great, right? So I know everyone's like, no, but it's good. We would rather have a full house than multiple service. How many of you guys have been to churches with multiple services? And it's just, you lose that family feel. So we're really asking the Lord to give us creative ideas to keep us as one. So we'll ride that out as long as we can. It's good.
All right. I want to add, so on our missions offering for the month of March, we was given close to $50,000. So let's give God praise for that. Amen. And, but here's my heart. I just want to say, that doesn't meet a lot of the needs that are about half of the needs that were on that board. I just want to just say, if the Lord moves on your heart, we're going to keep giving, you know, 10% of everything that comes in to forgiving, we give away to missions. And, but if the Lord is still just moving on your heart, you want to give, maybe you weren't available to, or able to, you know, during the month of March, It's not too late. We're going to keep that up. I just encourage you to continue to give. There's some needs we want to meet, specifically some of the things with our FCA and Scott Berkey in Kenya. And, of course, you guys gave amazing to Zibby. Wasn't Zibby amazing last week? Wow. And so if the Lord moves on your heart, you can still give. And we'll be giving to these projects all year long as the Lord provides. But I just want to pray over our offering, and then we'll hand it over. So, Lord, we just thank you, Father, for hearts that give. We thank you for a church that is generous, Lord. Lord, to say, I'm going to give, I'm going to sacrifice so that others can hear the gospel, Lord. And so, Lord, we just pray, Holy Spirit, as every person, I know many have already given this week, they give online different times, but Lord, we just pray as a moment of prayer together, Lord, we take our offering, Lord, that we have given, our tithes this week, Father, and say, multiply it, Lord. Take care of every need. Lord, we do this in faith. We give first. We give first in knowing that you will take care of the rest. So Lord, I just pray every person in here, Lord, that there would be something that happened, Lord, a divine gift or supernatural empowerment or whatever they need this week as they give. Holy Spirit, you will meet that need. In the name of Jesus, amen, amen. Well, I am really excited to invite George and Bot Witten up here, or George is going to start us here, and his wife. And one of the things I felt like we kind of missed on the March missions was talking about Israel. One of the things that we do is Israel, we give 1% of all of our entire budget to Israel ministries. We have a couple ministries that we support. But I felt like one of the things we didn't get to talk about is Israel and how important Israel is to give and to bless. And they are really, as Clay's in the middle of his end times, who's been going to the end times class? Isn't that awesome? It was jam-packed in there. Israel is a key to this whole thing. And I just felt like, man, I wish we had someone to really speak into that. So he's going to talk about that here in a second. But we connected together. I don't normally not preach for 4 weeks in a row. I miss it being up here. That's why I had to get a little preach in there for a second. But I just felt like this was so important that we needed to hear what God's saying about the nation of Israel. So George and his wife, that's their thing. They have a ministry teaching the body about Israel. So I can't wait to hear what he has got to say. Let's welcome him.
Amen. Now, if that's a clap for me, let's hear a bigger clap for words. It's all about him. Amen. Amen. If you're here this morning, you're here because God set you here in a divine appointment. How this meeting came about, for those that don't know, my brother suddenly passed away February 20th or 28th in 2020. And we were scheduled to go back home. We were scheduled to go back to Israel. My brother's 46 when he died. No one knows how much time you actually have left. And all of a sudden, I have a funeral. All of a sudden, the airline shut down. Everyone remember 10 days to flatten the curve? And the long story short is that we have been redeployed to America. We've done 77,000 miles now, preaching the gospel over 300 times in the pandemic while everyone's freaking out. God's word has to go forth. And what I mean by divine appointment, I came here, I'm staying with my friends Mike and Jackie. They have a nice driveway I can pull my RV in. And I dented my car. You know, all things work together for good, right? So I'm in a RV parking lot, and they pulled an RV in front of me. And my RV is 29 feet long, so it's got a big butt. You know, if you pull too quick to the left, the butt hits stuff. It hit one of those poles that don't move. So a couple $1,000s of damage. So I've been going around the country with this dent on my rear end. Very annoyed every time I look at it. And finally, I call Camping World in Alvarado. What is it?
Alvarado.
Alvarado. when I was talking to Pastor Jeff, I'm driving right by his old hometown. The same time that we're talking. It was a very bizarre conversation that happened the other day. But this part was supposed to come in 3 weeks ago. I had scheduled to go to the NRB, National Religious Broadcasters in Tennessee. I said, hey, you'll have it for 5 days. I'll be gone for 5 days. I'll come back, pick up RV, and I can get back on the road going all over the country. Our scheduled trip now is to go to Florida. So I'm trying to find meetings in Florida. So I call a guy, Pastor Arnie. Little do I realize that Pastor Arnie and I are talking. He goes, where are you staying? I'm staying in Lucas, Texas. He says, you know, Pastor Ben is in Lucas. I said, Pastor Ben is where? In Lucas? I said, he's not in Florida anymore? No, he moved to Lucas. So I call Pastor Ben. I hadn't talked to him in 2 years. Next thing you know, we're having lunch. The next time that we have lunch with Pastor Jeff, the part that was delayed finally is getting put on this Tuesday. So if you're here, it's because God set me delayed again. I've been delayed 2 years from going back. But that's the way God works. So if you're here, you're here for a divine reason, for a divine appointment. So Abba, Father, I ask you, Lord, that your ruach would pour out, that your spirit would pour out upon every person here. I ask you, Lord, that you give them ears to hear, eyes to see. I ask you, Lord, you prepare hearts, Father. And I praise you, Abba. I ask you, Lord, that your anointing would flow through me fresh and new. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. In the name of Jesus the Messiah, amen. I have been running a site for 20 years. It's called Worthy News. And Worthy News was founded on the verse, watch ye therefore and pray always and be found worthy to escape these things. The first thing about it is being a watchman. Now, the ancient Hebrew word for watchman, or one of the Hebrew words for watchman, is the word notzrim. Can you say it with me? Notzrim. You've just said the modern Hebrew word for Christian. The ancient Hebrew word for watchman is the modern word for Christian. We're all called to be watchmen. And how can we be a watchman? How can we pray into the events that are actually happening if you actually don't really know what's happening? And how many realize that we're praying that we may be found worthy to escape these things? Now, the very first thing that Jesus says when talking to the disciples about the last days, take heed that no man deceive you. That means there's a lot of liars today. That means you really can't trust the news today. It means you got to have someone with spiritual eyes and spiritual ears that is praying through the news to give you your prayer points for the day. And that's why I run a thing and I send out a daily brief. It is a daily devotional along with what's happening around the world, what's happening in Israel, what's happening in the United States, what's happening to believers all over the world. So that you have your prayer points for the day so you can fulfill your calling as a watchman. Now, I am of the persuasion, right, that it is not doom and gloom that we have coming. I am not a doom and gloom preacher. It is the beginning of a kingdom. It's not the end of the world. It's the beginning of a kingdom. And when you start understanding these things, now, when I talk about prophecy, I'm going to talk about a lot of different things. But I have to kind of give everyone an understanding where I'm coming from prophetically. When Jesus came, he said, I've come to preach the kingdom of God. And this was the purpose that he'd been sent. Right? The very after his resurrection, for 40 days, Jesus was preaching the kingdom of God. This is the Acts 1:3. The very beginning of Acts. The very last verse of Acts was Paul proclaiming the kingdom of God. So if we are disciples of Jesus and we're imitators of Jesus, then we should be imitating the message he preached. Now, the very first word of the kingdom message is repent. Repent, therefore, and turn again that your sins may be blotted out. Now, repent means you're going one way. It's not the right way. You turn to God, confess your sins, and there's a change in your life. Right now, we have a lot of confession, but not a turn. I want you to recognize that, because if we don't get this word repent down, we'll never have real revival. If you remember 9/11, in fear, every church was blacked out. Because the message repent wasn't preached, it was quickly forgotten. We have to have a true move of God. It's going to be by teaching what real repentance is. Now, there's a turn to God that you're birthed into the kingdom. And if you haven't been birthed into the kingdom, today is the best day ever, because you don't know if you have tomorrow. Now, I love this passage because it gives you the twofold understanding of repentance. It says, there may come seasons of refreshing. The word refreshing is fresh breath or revival. Now, the Lord tells us that we are married to him. He is the bridegroom and we are the bride. It's this marriage relationship. Now, Pastor Jeff and Pastor Sarah, how long you guys been married? Pastor Jeff and Pastor Sarah have been married 17 years. Can we give Pastor Sarah a big hand of applause for surviving 17 years? She has made it through 17 years with this man. Now, Pastor Jeff wants to stay in good relationship with his wife. When he said, I do, he was married. When we come into the kingdom and say, I will turn to you, Lord, you're in the kingdom. You're married to the bridegroom. Now, there's a lot of questions whether or not you're truly married. But now, Pastor Jeff never wants to be in the doghouse. He doesn't ever want to go ahead and be, if he's in the doghouse, it's because he did something wrong. Now, if you want to find out how many things I've done wrong, all you need to do is talk to my wife. But I warn you, you'll need a sleeping bag in about a week. We mess up. We're people without the kingdom body yet. We have the spirit, but we're still messing up in our flesh. If I want to stay in good relationship with my wife, I'm learning to say, I'm sorry. That's what staying in relationship with God is. When he says, season of refreshing, now if Pastor Jeff, right, goes ahead and buys flowers for his wife, he can't get more married. What he's showing is his love. See, that's works worthy of repentance. It's works because you've been redeemed, not works to be redeemed. You got to understand this, because in this marriage, if he goes and brings his flowers to his wife, he's not saying, can we get more married? What he's doing is he's proving his love to his wife. So I want you to get this understanding down, because this is probably I don't know how this gets messed up. It's so simple. There's a turn to God, and you're basically saying, I do. I realize I've messed up. I realize I need to turn to you. I realize you sent your son, that he's died for me. And that time, your sins are blotted out. The Lord is now looking to you in the righteousness of Jesus. And it says, now you got to walk this out. Living a lifestyle of repentance isn't a living a lifestyle to stay saved. Living a lifestyle of repentance is because I'm saved. Okay? So now we got that part down. That he may send you the Christ who's appointed for you, even Jesus, whom heaven must receive, ready until the times of the restoration of all things. I will show you from Scripture, God's getting ready to redeem everything back to how he originally created things. Whereof God spoke by the mouth of the holy prophets that have been from old. When Jesus and the apostles taught the message of the kingdom, there was not a New Testament yet. I want you to understand that. They taught the message out of the kingdom out of the Old Testament. That's why it's important to understand the Old Testament. See, a lot of people don't understand when the Lord says to the apostles, or certainly say to you, in the regeneration, you shall sit on the 12 tribes of Israel. That word regeneration is this really unique word in Greek. It's palingenesia. Palin means return to, genesis, Genesis. Return to Genesis. See, we're going to know. See, a lot of people study Revelation. If you really want to understand completely all of Revelation, you actually have to study the beginning. You shall know the end from the beginning. So now we have this passage in Isaiah. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb. A little child shall lead them. God is talking about restoring the animal kingdom. I want you to really grab hold of this. When Adam was naming the animals, was he worried that the lion was going to eat him? Now, there's some people that teach that we're in the kingdom now. Now, that is partially true. If the kingdom of God, if you're born again, the kingdom of God is within you. And you have the ability to tread on serpents and scorpions with that authority. That's kingdom authority. But we're not yet in the kingdom because every day we pray, thy will be done, thy kingdom come. There's a whole lot more good stuff coming. I want you to understand there's a whole lot more good stuff coming. Now, I love this idea about animals. Now, I have this dog, and I hesitate to call it a dog because it's little. To me, a dog has got to be at least Rottweiler size. I mean, the only thing that would really classify it as a dog is that it has a wagging tail. It literally is a glorified rat. Now, my dog jumps on the bed all the time. And my wife doesn't, and she's very nice and tidy and neat. Get those dirty paws off the bed. Stop letting the dog jump on the bed. I've now warned her. In the kingdom, baby, you're going to have to kick the lions off the bed. See, the kingdom is going to be so much different. He's very happy. He's very happy. Now, remember we said we're going to know the end from the beginning. We read in Revelation that God is going to destroy Mystery Babylon. Mystery Babylon, it's going back to Genesis, going to Babel, when the languages were changed. And the Bible tells us in the future, ready? I will turn to the people as a pure language, that they may call upon the name of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh with one consent. Call upon the name of Adonai with one consent. Now, when the Lord comes back and is preaching and teaching us from Jerusalem, do you think it's in English? What a Spanish. We're going back to a common language. In the future, will there be no need for an interpreter? We will all understand one another. I really love this promise. I've been married almost 20 years, and I really look forward to the day my wife finally understands me. The message of the kingdom, ready, is for everyone. There's a lot of tension because of racism being spoken about all the time. In the kingdom, there is no racism. There is one race called the human race, okay? And God is redeeming people from every tribe, language, people, and nation. And notice this, they've made him a kingdom, priest, or God, and they shall reign on the... Whoa! I thought we were going to heaven. Not yet. God is fulfilling a promise that he gave in Genesis 1. God told Adam, I give you dominion over the earth. Jesus is coming back, reestablishes his kingdom where? On the earth. We're ruling and reigning with Jesus on the earth. Okay, I want you to just grab hold of that. Because if you don't have a vision of the kingdom, you can get really stuck looking at everything that's happening right now. we got a lot of good stuff coming, right? Now, the thing is, when he says that we're kings and priests of the Most High God, we're a holy nation. We're a peculiar bunch. We ought to be a whole lot different than the world. You don't just look at Pastor Jeff and say, pastor is on a different level. He's a pastor. The reality is the same level you just assigned to Pastor Jeff of where you think his holiness should be is your own same level. Because we're all ministers of the gospel. And what you forget is that you're not here to be a pew sitter. You're actually here to be fed so you can fulfill your calling as a priest of the Most High God. And you're called to conquer as a king over serpents and scorpions and over all power of the enemy. You got to start accepting the authority that God has given you. You're not weak. God did not create you weak. God has instilled in you, if you're truly born again, he's instilled with you the Lion of Judah. I'm just trying to wake it up. Now, a lot of people teach the Gentiles have somehow replaced Israel. God is restoring all things. And what the Bible actually talks about is God restoring Gentiles who were once outside of the covenant promises of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They were alienated from the promises. But now, through the blood of Jesus, he has gone ahead and created in us one piece. He's made us one, that he might create us in us one new man. Jew and Gentile, right? That he has gone ahead and created us with one axis and one spirit, so we're no longer strangers. But now we're part of the fellowship of God. God was not replacing anyone. God was restoring you to a place of promise that you could not have until the Jewish Messiah came. Okay? And if you continue reading this thought process, this mystery was not made known to all these generations before. And the mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs. They're not sole heirs. They're fellow heirs. They're joining to the promises of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And this plan of mystery in ages of God was hidden. God's plan and revelation was so incredible, ready, that he might be made known to the rulers and authorities in heavenly places. The angels didn't even understand how great the plan of God was. That's what you're a part of. Now, if God has got a plan to restore Gentiles to a place of promise, doesn't it make sense, if he's redeeming people for every nation, tribe, and tongue, yeah, he has a plan for the Jewish people, right? I mean, it's not that hard to understand. Lord, we restore this kingdom to Israel. Now, blindness has happened in part, ready, until the fullness of the nations comes in. And then it says, then all of Israel shall be saved. You may ask yourself, how is national redemption going to take place? Well, the Bible says that I will pour upon the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. That sounds like Jews. The spirit of grace and supplication. That sounds like the Holy Spirit outpouring. And they shall look upon me whom they pierced. That sounds like a vision of Jesus. If you had a vision of Jesus, how could you not believe? But where we are right now is in the middle of a prophecy. We're in the middle where God talks about restoring the nation out of the dust of the earth. They were lost, scattered for 2,000 years. And he's redeeming them. And he talks about the flesh coming upon them, the bones coming. He's talking about a physical restoration. But notice this, there was no breath in them. The word breath is ruach, or Holy Spirit. To give you an understanding, in Israel, there's about 15,000 believers. You are here in Dallas, Texas. Ready? There are more Christians that go to Gateway Church in Dallas, Texas, than there are believers in all of Israel. I just want you to understand how much work we have to do to get a concept of that from a, you know, something you can relate to. But right now, we're in the middle of this prophecy. There's no breath in them. But the prophecy doesn't end there. He says, look, I'm going to raise you out of the graves. You're going to know that I'm the Lord, ready? When I put my spirit within you. that God's getting ready to pour out his spirit upon the Jewish people. And you have to understand that you're a part in all of this. Because if you don't understand what you're supposed to do, you're here at a prophetic time. You're here for this prophetic appointment. Ready? I asked, did they stumble that they might fall? And this is talking about the Jewish people. Rather, through the trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make what? Israel jealous. If you're a Gentile, like I am, God doesn't make mistakes. Except your calling to provoke Israel to jealousy. That's what our calling is. How do we provoke Israel to jealousy? By loving them just as Jesus loved them. I live in one of the most persecuted towns in all of Israel. I am surrounded at times by people spitting in my face, getting in my face, trying to get me to retaliate so I can get thrown in jail. Because we've had people in our own congregation that's been on house arrest for years until they got out when it was a false charge. That's what they try to do. But you have to understand that this rise of anti-Semitism, this rise to try to get you to have a disdain or a contempt, it's actually a test by God. Will you love your enemies? It says they're enemies for the gospel's sake, but they're love because God's got a plan for them. I want you to really grab hold of this, because this is a test. Because at the end of Matthew 25, when he gathers and he says, I'm separating the goats from the sheep, he goes through and says, did you feed me? He goes through this path, and then he says, what you did to my brethren. When he's speaking to Jewish people. You also did unto me. Now, if we're going to have a passion for the Jewish people, you have to understand they don't have another path into the kingdom. There's some people that say that the restoration of Israel, or the Jewish people back to the land, is the restoration of Israel. No, it is not. The restoration of Israel will not be completed until they come back to the Messiah. I want you to really grab hold of that. And they don't have another plan. When Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no man comes to the Father but by me, there is not a Gentile in that room. Make no mistake, because there's a lot of ministries saying you need to support Israel. Find their mission statement about what they support about the salvation of Israel. Really investigate, because you'll be like, why aren't you preaching the gospel? For those of us that are in the land actually preaching the gospel, that were surrounded by people that tried to intimidate me, no one wants to come. Those are people that just believe that they need the gospel. Isn't that what Jesus told us? But I want you to understand that there's a blessing coming. I do not think we attach enough importance to the restoration of the Jews. Those who were the first missionaries, the first apostles who are far off, for they shall be regathered in again. Until that shall be, the church's glory can never come. Read that again. Until that shall be, the church's glory can never come. Matchless benefits are tied to the restoration of the Jews, for their regathering shall be as life from the dead. And what Spurgeon is actually quoting is, if the rejection, talking about the Jewish people, the rejection means reconciliation of the world, what would their acceptance mean but life from the dead? I'm going to submit to you, if you want to have the really, really blessing of Israel, it's not financially supporting them as much as it is praying for their salvation and spiritually blessing them. See, if you pray into the salvation of Israel, salvation will come actually to your own house. When I got radically saved, I was a Grateful Deadhead, right? So for those that don't know, don't worry about it. But I got radically saved. When I got so radically saved, my parents thought I was nuts. When I told them I'm going to Israel in the middle of the suicide bomb, you know, there's people blowing up in buses. They thought I was absolutely insane. I moved to Israel with my wife 7 months pregnant. Not even 2 months after I moved to Israel, salvation came to my house. Both my mother and father finally got saved. There is a blessing when you start praying in the salvation of the Jewish people. Watch salvation come to your own house. I will bless them that bless thee. And there's a lot of people that say, I will bless them that bless thee, that are really financially prostituting Israel. And they don't even care about their salvation. That is a deep impactful understanding that you need to make. Now we get to the good stuff. See, prophecy is not for freaking people out. Would you believe it? It's not the end of the world. It's for upbuilding, encouragement, and comfort. God has got a plan. You're alive in this season for a plan to see the restoration of people from every nation, tribe, and tongue. That Jesus is coming back soon. We're going to rule and reign with him. And then after that, we get to go to the new heavens and the new Jerusalem. Okay, now we've got to figure out our plan. Now, I live in a country, you know, we're surrounded by a lot of people. And we're always threatened by war. You're going to hear about wars and rumors of wars. But the Lord says, ready? Stop freaking out. See that you're not troubled. For these things must come to pass. Now, I live in Israel. We're surrounded by 500 million Muslims that love us to death. Just should make that point out. We're surrounded, right? But I want you to understand that just because you're pro-Israel doesn't mean you're against Palestinians or against Egyptians or against Iranians. Because God's plan is to redeem people from every nation, tribe, and tongue. The Bible actually talks about there's going to be a highway coming out of Egypt to Assyria, a highway going right through the Middle East. It's called the King's Highway. And guess what? Blessed is my people, Egypt, and Assyria, the work of my hands, and Israel, my inheritance. God has got a plan to redeem the Ishmaelites. God's got a plan to redeem the Iranians. I'm really going to focus on the Iranians now, because when we talk about Iran, you actually won't find Iran in the Bible. You find the word Elam, E-L-A-M. This is the Elamite kingdom. You'll see the orange area is inside the modern state of Iran. So if you read this word E-L-A-M, Elam, you realize it's talking about Iran. Now, right now, there is a power struggle happening inside of Iran. They're in the middle of a civil war. They're starting to chant death to Khomeini, death to the dictator. And right now, Iran is getting closer and closer to a nuclear bomb. There's a lot of things happening prophetically. But I want to show you God's plan for Iran right now. It says, the Lord of hosts, behold, I will break the bow of Elam. I will bring Elam from the four winds of heaven, from the four quarters of heaven. I will scatter them to all these winds. And their nation and there shall be no nation to which those that are out of Elam shall not come. Now, Elam is Iran. Iran had the largest diaspora, millions of peoples fled, ready, after the Islamic Revolution of 1978 and 1979. Iranians fled all over the world. And every day on the anniversary of the Islamic Revolution, there are protests outside of every Iranian embassy because they want to go home. Now, I want to continue on this. It says, look, I will terrify Elam before their enemies. And before those who seek their life, I will bring disaster upon them. My fierce anger, declares the Lord. I will send a sword after them until it consume them. You may read this and say, a war is coming. Do not stop reading. All things work together for good. Look what it says next. I will set up my, what? Throne in Elam. Because Jesus is trying to set up his throne right here in Lucas, Texas. Jesus is trying to set up his throne in Dallas, Texas. Set up his throne in Washington, D.C. He says, I'm going to set up my throne in Iran. Notice this. I will destroy their kings and their officials, declares the Lord. Now, this is how we know it's a prophecy for us. This phrase, latter days, it's a phrase, it's acharit hayamim. In Hebrew, this is used about a dozen times in the Old Testament. This is connected to the Jewish people coming back to the land in the last days. It's connected to the Gog-Magog war of Ezekiel 38 and 39. It's connected to the Lord reestablishing his house on top of all the mountains in Isaiah 2. It's used here. Ready? God's not trying to destroy Iran. Look, I will restore Iran. You have to make this distinction because very often we can get caught up in a lot of these things and not realize that God has got a plan for the Iranians. We get caught up with everything that's happening. And we forget that the largest move of God is actually happening in Iran. Went from 100,000 believers to over 3 million believers. God is moving in the Middle East. But if you let the news dictate to you how you should pray, and if you don't understand God's plan of redeeming people from every nation, tribe, and tongue, you don't understand that God's got a plan for Egypt, God's got a plan for Iran, God's got a plan for Israel, the news will mess up your prayer life. How many people find it much more easier to pray for President Biden now? Just making a point. Here we are. I believe we're experiencing what's called a Jonah moment. Okay? Now, I got to take you back to Jonah because, you know, we read the story of Jonah and swallowed up by a great fish. We learn in Sunday school. But we actually don't study the history behind it. Jonah lived at the time of the Assyrian Empire. The Assyrians were the terrorists. They conquered by fear. They had a problem with someone, put them on a cross. They probably were looking for the people that were most influential. So they would say, Pastor Jeff, you're influencing too many people. We got to display you. They were probably looking for the mayors, the prophets. It doesn't say this in the Bible, but the Bible talks about schools of prophets. Chances are Jonah may have gone to a school of prophets. He probably knew a lot of people that were being crucified. I'm just giving you an understanding what Jonah was living through. At the same time, the Assyrian Empire was responsible for the dispersion of the northern 10 tribes of Israel. When we hear all the time about the lost tribes of Israel, it happened during the Assyrians. It happened during Jonah's day. Now, the Assyrians, they came up with an ingenious way of holding their land. They realized that, let's say the Galilee had 1 million people. It's very difficult to control 1 million people if they're unified. So we need to divide them. They literally picked up entire towns in the Galilee, picked it up and put a town in Iran. Picked up a town in Iran and moved it into the Galilee. Picked up another town in the Galilee, moved it to Syria. Picked up another town in Syria, moved it into the Galilee. Picked up another town, moved it into Egypt. Picked up another town. And what it had is a lot of different mixed people groups. You would read that as Samaritans in the Bible. That's how that happened. But God's orchestration of picking up entire towns and moving them actually allowed God's prophetic plan to be fulfilled 2,000 years later. Because if they had been moved individually and not as community, they would have just integrated into the nations. They would have lost their Jewish identity. God actually used the plan of picking up entire towns so they kept their Jewish identity for 2,000 years so the prophecies could be fulfilled 2,000 years later. We may think God has taken a long time. Look, that's 2 days in God's sight. I just want you to get hold of God's plan. We feel like, why aren't you here, Lord? I mean, that was only a second ago, buddy. I'm just giving you an understanding. So when Jonah was living, right, there was all these pagan idols being brought into the land. They're crucifying his brothers and sisters. They've taken the Jewish people out of the land. They've been promised the land of milk of land, milk of honey. Now I'm losing my track. Honey, help me. No. Yeah, okay. Sorry. I'm getting a little sidetracked. But the point I'm making is this. When Jesus came on the scene, he was in the Galilee. It was full of all of these people that came from all these other nations. So when the rabbi said, what good thing could come out of the Galilee? It's because the Jewish identity had almost been gone in the Galilee. You have to understand, when Jesus went to Gadara and he meets the demoniac, and out of the demoniac cast a legion into a herd of swine, that's pigs, do you think that's a Jewish farmer? Where'd he come from? It came from this point, okay? So to give you an understanding, so it would be like Jonah. God's saying to you, I need you to go to the Taliban in Kabul. God, they just killed a bunch of Christians. I need you to go to the Taliban in Kabul. Are you sending me on a suicide mission? I need you to go to the Taliban in Kabul. Jonah goes to Joppa. which is Tel Aviv. Now, to understand, he is supposed to go east. He goes to Joppa to board a ship to go to Tarshish. That's Spain. You can't run more west than Spain in Jonah's day. Now listen, if you got swallowed up by a great fish and you were in the belly for 3 days and three nights, you'd have a heart adjustment too. Jonah goes. The greatest revival in the world takes place under Jonah's day. And Jonah's response is, "Would you please kill me?" Jonah's hatred for the terrorists was greater than his concept of God's love for them. So, and I pity that nation that doesn't know the right hand from the left. You can get caught up. The Iranians are calling death to America, death to Israel. God, you need to wipe them out. And not even realize you develop the same spirit that James and John had when they walked through Samaria. They don't receive us, Lord, so we call down fire from heaven. Jesus turned to rebuke them. Jesus did not come to destroy. Jesus came to save. He came to save the terrorists. He came to save Antifa. He came to save everyone that's so wayward and lost. If you start letting the news dictate how you pray, you've lost your ability to have a heart for them. And that's what God wants you. He wants you to have the heart, your heart right in this matter. Where we are right now, there's a very interesting war that has been revealed to us in Scripture. It says, this is a war, and Daniel is sitting there, and he's praying. He's like, "Lord, Lord, will you answer my prayer?" And it says, "But the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. That's not a prince, that's a principality. Persia is modern-day Iran. We read Michael as the archangel watches over the Jewish people. There's a spiritual war that happens, and it happens for 21 days. The reason why we read this war, look at this carefully, to help you understand what is to happen to your people, the Jewish people, in the end of the end of days. The war that's happening in the Middle East is a spiritual war. We have to understand our part in this spiritual war. We're kings and priests of the Most High God. He's given us authority to tread on serpents and scorpions. He's given us authority to break the chains. But if you're praying the wrong way, God, would you destroy them? God's not answering that prayer. God, would you reveal Yeshua to them? Because we know that true peace is only coming to the Middle East when the Prince of Peace comes. See, your watchman, prophetically speaking, says, "I've set up watchmen on your walls, Jerusalem." This is a picture of you. They will pray. They will not be silent. You that put the Lord to remembrance, take no rest and give no rest until what? Until Jerusalem is appraised in all the earth. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. When you're praying for the peace of Jerusalem, what you're really praying for is, ready? The salvation of Israel. Because remember what he said? He said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I wish I could gather you under my wings. But you would not. You shall not see me again until you say, Baruch Abba B'Shem Adonai. Until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." That's why it's so important to pray for the salvation of Israel. Because it's connected to your own blessing. It's connected to your own revival. It's connected to what you're called to do in these last days. You're kings and priests of the Most High God. I'm going to close out with this. I won't turn that off. I don't know why it's there. Oh, there, I'll get back one. Okay, here we go. The message of restoration, the true message of restoration is destroying everything that was lost of the garden. What was truly lost of the garden? Relationship. Adam walked with God in the garden. He was able to walk with him intimately in the garden. Jesus came to undo that so you could have relationship again. But in order to deal with sin, you can't be like Adam. the woman that thou gavest me. If you sin, it's no one else's fault. It is no one else's fault. You better accept your own fault in it so you can be in right relationship. Jesus came so that we would always be in right relationship. And if there's ever a time we need to hear the voice of God, and ever a time that we need to be in right relationship with God, it's right now, because the world is going nuts. But if you're in right relationship with God, you're like in the middle of the eye of the hurricane, and you look up and the birds are flying, and the world all around you is going nuts. That's what it's been like for me for years. I've been in the middle of Israel, in the middle of all the suicide bombings. Aren't you going to leave it? I mean, it's dangerous over there. No, the most dangerous place to be is outside the will of God. And God's will for you today is to be in right relationship. That's what Jesus came to deal with. Repent. Turn to God, that your sins may be washed away. And then if you want to walk in revival, you got to deal with all the little sins. Because if you think you've arrived, you're already backsliding. The reality is, if we're in this tight relationship with God, we're like Isaiah. The prophet Isaiah is in the presence of God. He says, woe is me, I'm a man of unclean lips. He says later, my righteousness is nothing but filthy rags. He realized it was all about him. When you come to that place, God is going to use you to move mountains. God is going to use you to shake kingdoms. God is going to use you to preach to kings. That's where we need to be. We need to be in that kind of relationship in these last days. So Abba, Father, I ask you, Lord, that you would seal this word. I ask you, Father, that you would pour out your spirit fresh and new. I ask you, Father, that you would give every person here a fresh understanding of intimate relationship. The bridegroom is coming, and he's making the bride ready. So I ask you, Father, that you will pour out your spirit and make this bride in this room ready. You brought them here for this divine appointment. May they come to proper relationship in every area of their lives. I ask you, Father, that you would start revealing to them issues, that we may turn over every area of our life to you. Father, I ask you, Lord, that you would do a work in this room. I ask you, Father, that your spirit would be poured out new. Pour out a spirit, Father, repentance. I praise you, Abba, and I thank you for what you're doing. B'Shem, Yeshua, HaMashiach, in the name of Jesus, the Messiah. My wife is going to come up, and I don't know what mic she's supposed to use. You got her, okay. She's going to come up, and she's going to sing the Aaronic benediction, which is the blessing going over. Anyone who needs prayer, I guess we have prayer teams, because I saw you earlier. Set up prayer teams and deal with whatever God's dealing with you. It's a good thing that God's dealing with you. That means because you're not dead. God is trying to shake you up. It says in Hebrews, I once spoke and the earth shook. I'm speaking again from heaven, and everything that's not of the kingdom is going to be destroyed. It's time to get our lives in alignment with what God is doing.
Thank you, Abba. I feel like in my spirit that there's a need for us to respond somehow. Do you feel that? I don't know how that would be for you, but Lord, we just we ask you, Father, Lord, that you would just turn our hearts to you. Turn our hearts to you, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would release faith. Lord, I pray you would release faith for impossible things, for experiences with you. Lord, this is how I feel. I feel for the young people. Lord, I pray for experiences, deep experiences with you, Lord. You said your old men would dream dreams and your young men see visions. I just pray that, Lord, that you would just release dreams and visions. Lord, we thank you, Abba, for what you are doing, Lord, in this time and place. Thank you, Abba. Thank you, Abba. Yes, Abba. Ooh, yes, Lord, yes. If you want a touch from the Lord and you feel like you need to come up here and let him deal with you. I know we did a little earlier, but if there's still somebody in here that needs a touch from you, a fresh touch, a fresh anointing, a fresh understanding, a fresh relationship, renew. Oh, renew. Revive us, Lord. Oh, do a new thing, Lord. We want the new thing. We don't want the old thing anymore, Lord. We want the new thing that you're doing, Lord. We want to be in alignment with you, God. You help us, Lord, to be in alignment with you. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Say yes, Lord, if that's you. Oh, say yes, Lord. Oh, just lift up your hands and say yes, Lord. Oh, take me, Lord. Oh, to the new thing with me, Lord. Oh, I long to serve you. I long to worship you in spirit and in truth. Adonai, there is none like you, my Lord. Osefele, doing wonders. You've done wonders, Lord, in our lives, and we've seen you do wonders, and we've read about your wonders in the Word. If you can do those wonders, you can do it again. Amen. Amen. Speak it out. Thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, you are. Yes, Lord. Oh, faithful. Oh, forever you will be. Sing it. Oh, faithful you are. Because he is. Oh, faithful. Forever you will be. Keep us and carry us. Lazman hazeh for such a time as this. The disciples, they would have died to have to see this with the stuff that's going on in the world today. We're blessed. Amen. And the Lord wants to put his blessing upon you. And there is a prayer, and I know you already have his blessing, right? But there's a prayer that the Jews have been singing for many, many, many years. Did you want to say something? Sorry. I just saw that. And Carrie Job took this song, and I love the girl. But I thought it was funny because the whole world went crazy over this song and started sending in their YouTube videos of doing it in like a million different languages. Who saw that? The Blessing. You guys know that song? And I just thought it was funny because, you know, the Jews have been praying this prayer for thousands of years. And it's a powerful prayer. It was written by God himself. It comes from Numbers 6, telling Moses to pray this over the people, that his blessing, that his name would be upon them. How many want that? How many want God's name to be upon you? If some of you want to come up front, I would be honored to pray this prayer over you in the original language of Hebrew. And so, if Pastor, you have nothing else, okay.
Yeah. Just guys, keep playing for a second. I felt like when we were talking there, I just felt a tinge of that kind of animosity with the Muslim people, and I just felt, man, we gotta pray. Can we all just stand up for just a second? I want us to pray for the salvation of Muslims. Can we do that? So, Lord, we just pray right now, God.
Yes.
For Iran and Saudi Arabia and all these Muslim countries and those that are right here in this is a hub right here in Allen, Texas, God, we pray for those, God, who are far away from you. They have a form of religion, God, but they don't know the true one, Jesus. And so, Lord, we just pray for our Muslim brothers and sisters, those who are in this world, Father. We pray for them, God. We pray for their salvation. We pray for dreams, God. We pray that they would see you, God. We pray that you would come to them, Lord. I pray you would send workers into the harvest, Lord, who will speak the truth, God, that are trained, Lord, that also have the understanding and the wisdom of, Lord, how to speak into their lives, God. We just pray, Father, right now, revival. Lord, we thank you for what's happening in Iran, Lord. We pray, Lord, just continue. Protect those Christians, Lord, in Iran, Lord. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that, Father, in just this town, God, where there's so many Muslim families, we pray a revival, Lord. Touch their hearts, Lord. Show them Jesus. Show them, Holy Spirit. Show them. And now I want to pray for Israel. Lord, we just pray for the salvation of the Israel, of the Jewish people, Father. It breaks my heart that this is 15,000 Christians, Lord, in this land. Lord, we just pray, Holy Spirit, for their salvation of the Jewish people, God. Bring salvation to them, Father. In the name of Jesus, unveil their eyes, Lord. Take the veil off so that they can see the truth of you, Jesus. God, and I pray for a burden, Lord, to be placed on us for the Jewish nation and for the Muslim people, Lord. We just pray, Lord, right now, God, for a burden. Can we just say, ask, Lord, give me a burden. Just say it out, Lord, give me a burden, Lord. Give me a burden for the loss, and especially for those Jewish people and the Muslim people. Lord, give me a burden for them, God. Give me a burden, Father. Lord, let it burn in me, Lord, that I got to pray. I got to pray. I got to do my part. We bless the nation of Israel. We bless the Jewish people, Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Yes. Yes.
So did you want to, you said you want to pray for them individually, or did you want to sing it?
I'm going to sing that song.
Okay, okay.
Them, if that's okay.
Yeah.
I just want to ask my brother to come up here, who my Egyptian brother that I met earlier in the hallway. Are you in here? Where's my Egyptian brother? Is he in? No? Oh. Oh. Shoot. Wow, that would have been cool. All right. Oh, Lord, we just praise you and thank you, God. Lord, would you just place your name upon us. And stay standing. I think this is appropriate. And come forward. I would love to pray for you. Please, you can fill up this thing here. I just want to pray over you. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'chuneka. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yasim lecha shalom. Salam, 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 shalom in Arabic. Lord bless you and keep you. Gracious to you. The Lord turns his face toward you, yeah, and give you peace, his precious peace. And we all agree and we sing. Thank you. The joy of the Lord. And something else the Lord has really been impressing me upon me this whole time of this pandemic, that my husband and I and our two teenagers have been living in a little camper for all this time, because I don't know if my husband talked about it, but we've been stuck here. We like to call it redeployed now. But, you know, it's been not been easy. But the Lord really has been impressing upon my heart the utter need to worship. Because that is what's going to get us through. And not only is that what it's going to get us through, it is literally our job. You might think you have like a 9-to-5, but God actually created us to worship Him. That's our job, if you really think about it. And I don't care what you have to do. I don't care if you have to like turn up the worship music in your house 24/7 loud, maybe to knock out all the other sounds and all the other ways the enemy is trying to like make, you know, he does that. Make waves, you make them louder. You make them louder in Yeshua, in Jesus. Turn up the worship in your car, in your office. I don't, you know, wear your earbuds. I don't know. But we have to learn to worship Him. That is the only thing that is going to get us through this stuff. It's the only thing, because it's what we were born to do. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Wow. Wow. Presence of the Lord is in this place. Can we just give it up for this amazing couple and what they brought to us? I know they have some stuff out there in the foyer that you can get to help sell to help with their ministry. But I'm going to formally dismiss us, and we got prayed over the blessing. And we're going to open these altars up. We'll just continue. If you need time with the Lord, you want to pray with somebody to do that. But just bless you guys. Have an amazing week, and we'll see you soon.
Be still, my soul.